folks that I've worked with that are younger than me are learning it faster than I learned it. So does it take 5 years? I'm not convinced anymore. I used to be waving the 5 years takes 5 years flag. That I'm starting to loosen up on that, but not the life experience part. That there's something to be said about that.
It's hard to be Yoda at 18.
Yeah, that's right.
Is that a baby boomer reference?
Yeah. No, I got that one too.
I would say pushing the intangibles, you know, the work-life balance, the telework, that's one. You know, I think that's a huge plus, but again, you have to riff what motivates one may not motivate another. I think training is another one. I'll speak for myself, the amount of training that I get, and I know a lot of my younger colleagues get, it's impressive, and it really means a lot to me. You know, during the hiring freeze, you know, I missed out on a promotion that my supervisors wanted me to get, and the training was there, and it felt good to have that, to say, you know, I'm gonna relax, it's a journey, you know, it's not that big of a deal, I'm gonna continue on taking advantage of training, and I'd like to think that I speak for more millennials that enjoy the training. I think that's, you know, we're talking at all the way up to, you know, perhaps $10,000 a year. That's a lot of money that you might not get in a private company. So I think that's a perk. So I would say the work-life balance, pushing the intangibles, and also pushing the mission, finding the right people. You know, you don't want to have the wrong person. You want to have the right person. You know, why are marine commercials so crazy? It's because they want people that are a little bit crazy. You know, at the end of the day. So I think you have to, you know, target the right people. And I think millennials, are showing that they believe that being a part of an organization that makes a change is very important. So if you have an important mission like DHS, Homeland Security, you know, make sure you're pushing that, and you're pushing some of those intangibles, and that's the right way to go. But it'll definitely it'd be a challenge, because at the end of the day, when you can make $40,000 or $50,000 more somewhere else, you know, that's tough. But perhaps you're letting go of the people that should go anyway, because you know, federal service is public service, and you're a public servant, so you have to be willing to make sacrifices. And you know, I think some people just think to leave, they want to leave, but at the end of the day, you know, especially the fact that a lot of millennials, this is their first presidential transition, and I would like to say that it's probably a pretty traumatic one, you know, for a lot of common reasons. So I think some people want to stick around to see if you know another transition is the same, or what those are like. So it's important for older generations to say, to sit down with the longer employees that are leaving and say, hey, think about your retirement. You know, you may not join the same retirement in the future. You know, in this little cyclical of new presidential transitions, good times will come and bad times will come. And I think that it's a bumpy road right now, and it's important for baby boomers and Gen Xers to sit down with millennials and say and explain that. And a few people did that for myself and others, put things in perspective, and it's been great. And I think at the end of the day, we have to live in the moment and be mindful. We're always thinking ahead. And it's like, how can the future be bright if the moment isn't bright? So.
I just wanted to piggyback on what you said, John, that about the intangibles. And it was interesting. the feeling of public service wanting to work was one of the attributes of the baby boomers, but it was also one of the attributes of the millennials, that mission, you know, making a difference in the mission. So it's kind of the same thing as with the baby boomers and the millennials in terms of the intangibles that are important to the boomers.
Let me ask a summary question as we're getting toward the end. And I'll ask each of you to make a statement on this. If you had to distill down to one piece of advice to give managers, what would you say would be the key piece of advice that you would give for effectively leading and managing both within their own generation and across others? So a generational perspective on managing the workforce, which might be to say disregard generations and just make it personal specific, but at a high level.
Where I was going with that, but as a the cohort that's in the middle, we've been navigating this for a long time, sort of managing up and then managing down to the team. And so I think the distilled phrase is, if you're able to, if your team is in of hundreds or thousands, to get to know your team, spend the time with them, take care of them, and they will take care of you.
I was going to say exactly, yeah, take care of the people and the rest will take care of itself. I think it's about, I mentioned the first sergeant in the Army. Often the first sergeant is probably one of the coolest leadership positions I've ever seen, because it's essentially someone who worked their way up the rank. And you know when you're getting an order from a first sergeant, it's someone that's been there, done that. And at the same time, it's someone that is going to be on that rough march with you doing the same thing. So I think it's important as a leader to, and a manager, and it cuts down generations, is to make sure that you are asking, when you're asking, making decisions and motivating individuals, that you're putting yourself in their shoes. It doesn't mean you have to had done it, but that you would do it, though, if you're asking someone to do it. So I think breaking down the barriers, and at the end of the day, you know, a human being was born 80 years ago versus, you know, 10 years ago is going to, you know, want to be treated with respect. So I think my most important thing would be, you know, it would be kindness. I think some people, they take that for granted. You have to be, you know, you got to be kind to people. You know, but at the end of the day, I mean, the world's pretty rough out there. And you do need a certain point where you get a kick in the butt and say, go do it. And those are important times to do it, you know, to push your employees to the next step. But do it in a kind way. So when someone's, you know, retiring, you know, be kind about, you know, how you talk to them, you know, and cognizant of the way they're feeling. And someone with a millennial, the same sort of way. You know, people want to be treated with respect.
And I'd say very similar to what you all have been saying is keep an open mind, that baby boomers can learn new tricks from the Gen Xers and the millennials. And also, I think baby boomers really need to be respectful of the Gen Xers and the millennials, and then they will respect your experience if you treat them with respect. So same sort of things. We all came around to the same thing.
That makes me think of one thing. At GSA, they have a retirement program, I'm not sure they still have it, where you can take an hourly rate as you retire and sit down and mentor someone. And I think that is just excellent, you know, to allow someone to pass down that knowledge. You know, some of my, you know, my best mentor, you know, Jim Lilac, he's going to be retiring at 70 years old. And he's, you know, he took me underneath his wing from day one, and it was really good to me. I think he's going to take advantage of that. So I think that's a good idea, is mentor matchmaking. And the fact that you're sitting here and you're retired, I mean, that's just excellent. You know, I'd be in Bahamas if I were you, so.
I was there last week. Yeah. Deb caught me at a good time.
In between islands.
Yeah.
Any other questions or comments from the audience that you want to get out? Well, I
certainly want to thank the panel very much. Each of you contributed very well, as we knew that you would. And we will certainly hope to have you back for some future event. Deb, do you have any closing comments that you wanted? Did we talk about next month?
No, we haven't talked about next month. Our next meeting is scheduled to be on the topic of succession planning, which is actually a good second meeting after we talked about generational differences, because we need to be thinking about succession planning. That's going to be taking place. It does appear that retirements are picking up, and that means succession planning for those positions that are now becoming open is very important. So I hope that you will all consider attending that session. I also wanted to give my personal thanks to the panel, who have been my colleagues and friends. John, you're my new colleague and new friend over the years, and really appreciate the insights that they have. I think it's very encouraging and refreshing to hear that, you know, we all come through our generational groups and we kind of have the cultural lens that we use. Jimmy, you referred to it through the movies, through the I never was in high school when we were allowed to wear even slacks to school. We had to wear dresses every single day. So you come up through your life with certain cultural perspectives and experiences that do form bonds, I think, with people that you are in that same cohort with. But be that as it may, we are all much more individual than we are characterized by our generational cultural awareness. And I think that really came through loud and clear today in very, very helpful discussion. So thank you very much. I'd like for all of us to give them a round of applause. Thank you for your time and for your participation. We really appreciate it.
And thank you to the audience in the room, and thank you to the audience on the phone. Well, we're signing off, so thank you, and we'll see you next month.